I think we should probably get started. It's a few minutes after 2 California time. I am happy to see so many people, so many familiar faces, and happy to be talking about Dickens and to be talking about Dombey and Son. And
yes,
I am. I'm. You know who I am. I'm John Jordan, and I don't intend to talk at you very much. I'll say just a few words of introduction, some thoughts that I have about the novel, and we're gonna, you know, the ground rules are that we're gonna read a certain number of chapters for each of the four sessions. And so we have to, you know, there may be some people who haven't read the whole novel, so we don't want to give anything away. So we'll restrict our conversation to the first 10 chapters. And I'm thrilled to be spending time with Dombey and Son, because I think it is truly a great novel. I mean, a lot of people say that it's the first novel of Dickens's maturity. And this is not to say that the novels that he wrote before that were not any good, but I think this is an exceptional novel. And one of the ways in which it's exceptional is that Dickens took more time off in advance before he began writing this novel. And he planned it more carefully than he had planned any of the other novels before that. And you can tell that in lots of ways. It's organization, it's structure, the plot lines. And one indication of that is that this is the first novel for which he did plans in advance, the so-called number plans. And it's another one of the novels that is published in serial parts in over 19 months in 20 parts, with the last part being a double number. And so when you read it, one of the things that I think is really important is to think about each monthly number as a structural part, to think about what holds that monthly number together, because Victorian readers were reading it in those monthly installments and trying to, you know, think about what's going to happen next and how this piece fits with the piece that came before and all of that. And so there are also some ways in which I think just at the level of language, it's a more mature novel. There are just passages of extraordinarily powerful prose, particularly the descriptions of the house, of the Dombey house, that are just extraordinary. They're lyrical, they're melancholy, they're profound. If you think about the novels that came before this, they're all pretty much linear in organization. That is, they deal with a series of adventures, and sometimes, you know, adventures is even in the title of the novel. And this is the first novel that's not linear in its organization. It's you can tell that in part from the title. It's not The Adventures of Mr. Dombey, or The Adventures of Paul, or The Adventures of Walter Gay. It's Dombey and Son. And the full title, of course, is an expansion on that. But Dombey and Son, as a title, is the name of a place, and it's the name of a business, and it's the name of a family. And in that sense, it's a title that doesn't promise a sequence of adventures. It foregrounds a place, a family, a business. And in that sense, I think it's more organized around place than it is around than the previous novels, the novels that led up to it. And just one example in the chapters 1 through 10 that we read, that I'll call attention to as an example of the way in which it's a better organized novel, is that the third monthly number, chapters 8, 9, and 10, form a wonderful unit around the theme of money. And in chapter 8, there's that great scene where little Paul says, "Papa, what's money?" You know, this profound question that goes to the heart of everything in the novel, and to the relationship between son and father, and Dombey's sense of who he is and what the business is, and can money do anything? And Dombey confidently says, "Yes, money can do anything," but it turns out it can't save my mama. But the next two chapters in monthly number 3 also deal with money, and they go to the Walter plot. And in chapter 9, we learned that Saul Gillis's business is at risk because there a note has been signed, and the loan is being foreclosed, Mr. Broly, and so they have to figure out what to do to save Uncle Saul's shop. And so Captain Cuttle shows up on the scene, and Captain Cuttle has an idea. And so the question is money. Where are they going to get money to save Uncle Saul? And the obvious place Captain Cuttle comes up with the beautiful plan is to go to Mr. Dombey, who in a sense has to repay a debt to Walter, because Walter has found Florence. Walter has found Florence, and so he has a reasonable expectation that Mr. Dombey might want to do something to recognize that that action. And so they go to visit Mr. Dombey. And again, the all three chapters deal with money. So it all spins out of that question, that one question that Paul asks in chapter 8, "Papa, what is money?" So it's a novel that is just beautifully organized. I'm interested in what you think about it. I'll tell you a couple of themes that I'm interested in that are perhaps not as obvious, but I'm interested in the minor characters. What are they doing? What is Major Bagstock up to? What about Miss Tox? Susan Nipper? There are just so many wonderful minor characters in this novel. And another thing I'm interested in is the role of women. And of course, Dombey and Son names a father and a son. It's a very masculine novel. But from the very beginning, there are women in the novel. And so I'm interested in what you think about the gender relations in this opening section of the novel. And of course, later on, you know, we're going to have what I think is probably Dickens' most powerful female figure, or certainly one of his most powerful female figures. She is in reserve now. She has not showed up on the scene. But I'm interested in the way that women are represented, and the question of power. What is the room for female action and female influence and female power in these first three chapters of the novel? So that's as much as I wanted to say by way of start. I'm not gonna, as I say, I don't want to lecture at you, but it's a wonderful novel. So I'm excited to get your reactions and find out what you would like to talk about. So I'll sit back and ask you to propose something that you would like to discuss. And I'm just gonna, I see Glenna. Why don't you start us? People should raise their hands when they wanna talk.
I was really struck last night when I was rereading it, that how the character of Polly Toodle is such an interesting character. and her husband defers to her. And that is so different than we've just been reading Pickwick Papers. And, you know, there are so many bossy women in that who are seen, you know, as the, perpetrators of henpecking of their husbands. And here, instead of that kind of a dynamic, you have Polly Toodle as, a source of an entirely positive character, and her husband defers to her wisdom. And the other thing I wanted to say before I yield the floor is that every time I read this novel, I just love the way he writes about Paul. I mean, it's not a realistic portrait of a child. You know, he's old and he says these odd things, but oh my goodness, it's just so, there's some kind of truth that's not realism. And the dialogue between little Paul and Mrs. Pipchin is just extraordinary. And yes, I love, love, love this novel.
Yes, yes. Okay, thanks. Well, there's a lot of in what you said that we could explore further. So yes, Polly Toodle, and her husband defers to her. Is she exceptional in that regard, as a woman who seems to have more influence or power than her male counterpart or the men in her world?
I have a question regarding that.
Go ahead.
I got the impression with Polly and also with Susan Nipper that maybe these women workers were unionized in a way. Polly comes out of an agency, right?
Yes.
She's part of an agency that provides wet nurses for families. And when Susan talks to her, because Susan feels a little threatened, right? And when she talks to her about, I had trouble with that sentence, and so did Jody. But I got she says something like, you know, you're just temporary and I'm permanent and I'm not planning to give up my place. But she says something that sort of indicates like there are plenty of opportunities out there. Yeah. And so I wondered, you know, were women, did they have sort of like organization, employment agencies?
No, this is talk about.
Yeah, I Polly's Miss Tox is the one who finds Polly. And she's Fox is Polly. I'm sorry, is Maxine talking? I'll go ahead. Can people hear? Yes. Okay. I don't know enough about the employment agencies that existed at the time. It seems that Polly in some way registered at an agency that makes services of wet nurses available to families that are in need. And Ms. Tox has gone and found her and brought her to provide this service for the Dombey family.
Right. So, but then it's the question I have is on the last paragraph of chapter 3, when Susan says, "Oh, being only a permanency, I couldn't be expected to show it like a temporary." Temporaries carries it all before him here, I find. But though there's an excellent party wall between this house I mayn't exactly like to go to it. What is that party wall about?
The party wall is part of the architecture of the building. So there's a wall between this house and the house next door. But this is what you're identifying is a couple of things I think that I can maybe help to clarify. I mean, one is the distinction between permanent temporaries and permanencies.
I understand that.
Yeah, and Polly is a temporary because she has been hired to provide a service that is time limited, and Susan, who is the maid.
Oh, yeah, servant, I understand that. It's the question. Yeah.
But yeah. Let me just say one more thing about that. There's another dimension to the distinction between permanencies and temporaries, which is who is going to be permanent and who is going to be temporary in this family, and that question will echo down the next few chapters beyond where we have read. So it's a significant distinction that Susan, in her unusual rhetoric, is calling attention to that will be thematically important. So the second thing is to explain this sentence that doesn't make very much sense, but you shouldn't always try to make sense of what Susan says. What you should try and make sense of is the linguistic structure, the syntax of the sentence, because what Susan is a version of Sam Weller. You've just finished reading Pickwick papers, and Sam has a particular way of speaking. He has what has come to be known as Wellerisms, and he tells a little fable. Well, Susan is a variation on that mode. Susan's mode of speech is the contradiction. And her sentences start out in one direction, and then she says, but, and then she switches direction and goes in a different way. And the logic is not what holds the sentence together. What holds the sentence together is that Susan is a contradiction. Susan wants to contradict whatever anybody else is doing. She's black-eyed Susan. She's a nipper. And so just think about whatever comes out of Susan's mouth as embodying the principle of contradiction.
Thank you. That's the part I needed.
Yes. So, I mean, just to read the sentence, temporaries carries it all before him here, I find, but though there's an excellent party wall between this house and the next, so it sounds like we've got a sentence going for us. I mayn't exactly like to go to it, Mrs. Richard, notwithstanding. It makes no sense, except, you know, there is a wall and I may go to it or I may not.
But it's up to me to decide.
Yeah, it's up to me. She's fiercely stating her independence and her wish not to be guided by the rules of English grammar and English syntax. But so Polly Toodle is a good example. There are other women at the beginning of this novel. And I'm interested, for example, in Mrs. Chick and Miss Tox. So what do people think about Mrs. Chick, first of all? She's a relatively minor character, but I think her, you know, she's one of the women who appear in chapter one. Who is she, first of all?
She's Mr. Dombey's sister.
She's Mr. Dombey's sister. Yeah. Okay. And what's her relationship with her brother like?
Well, it says that she is one of his strongest influencers.
Does that seem correct to you?
Well, he defers
I think she plays the fence with her brother, trying to be his supporter, but really his inferior.
Well, the Dombey world is a patriarchal world, right?
Yeah.
You know, it's girls are not important. Girls are a base form of coin, as the narrator tells us at one point. Again, that metaphor that comes from money. But does Mrs. Chick exert any influence over her brother?
Yes.
How does she do it?
There's him. But I found that her name being Chick symbolized a lack of maturity. She's not a full-grown chicken. She's just a little chick.
Go ahead.
I was going to say she echoes the way in which Mr. Dombey is totally oblivious to his wife and what's going on. She's the one that shows at the very beginning where women stand in a man's world. And she, of course, wants to be liked by her brother because she's looking for money as well. So she has her own ulterior motives. That's how I saw it.
Okay.
I don't think it's money, I think it's power. Because that conversation before they go to the christening, that she keeps interrupting him and she's making an assumption of where he's going. And she's wrong about where he's going, but it seems to me she tests the waters every time before she says anything. He's got all the power and, oh, it's a Dombey. I'm a Dombey. You know, that's where the power is and that's what she's trying to do. And she flatters him too. At some point, the word flatter is used.
It also proves that Mrs. Dombey has no power within that house. It accentuates the difference between what should have happened in welcoming a child and supporting a mother into what really happened.
So I'm not always able to see who's raising hands. So please forgive me. If there's anyone who, Courtney can help me with that, and I can call on people. So I see Gary raising a hand.
I would say with the death of Mrs. Dombey, I think that she has quite a bit of influence given the dynamics of the situation. Yeah. And in some ways she starts a chain reaction. She introduces Miss Tox, who introduces Miss Pipchin, and she even alludes to the fact that is it Miss Tox could marry Mr. Dombey? I mean, it's a very interesting dynamic that's happening there with her. So I would say she's a very powerful character.
I'm noticing
given her role and how much power she has.
It's not Mrs. Dombey. It's Mrs. Chip. It's not Mrs. Dombey, but people are referring to her as though she is Mrs. Dombey, but she's the sister.
She of course is a chick is her husband's name. It's her married name. But she considers herself a Dombey. And one of the things that she frequently says in those opening chapters, that especially that first chapter, is that Fanny, that is the Mrs. Dombey who is now deceased, was never a Dombey. And so in that sense, she bolsters the patriarchy. She bolsters the concept that the most important thing in the world is the Dombey lineage, which is a patriarchal lineage. So women are in a subservient place, but that doesn't mean that they're without power. Right. They have other ways to exert power. And one of the ways that it's a small instance early in the novel, but Mrs. Chick says, and I can't quote it, but, oh, I need a glass of wine. Paul, won't you get me a glass of wine? And Dombey goes and gets her a glass and brings it to her and she drinks the wine. So she has a way to get Dombey to do what she wants him to do. And one of the ways that she does that is by playing the feminine weak card. Oh, I'm too weak to get a glass of wine for myself. Won't you do it? And Dombey obeys. Dombey has been put into the subservient position. Here, he's a servant. He's bringing her a glass of something to drink. So she knows that women are subordinate, but that doesn't mean that she doesn't know how to use influence to get around patriarchy and get her way. So Gary has mentioned some other examples of that, that she's the one who introduces Miss Tox. And Mrs. Chick has her own agenda for the future. What are Mrs. Chick's agendas? There may be more than one.
So I'll help John identify folks who want to speak. If you either want to raise your hand physically or use the hand raise function, I'll do my best to keep up with everyone.
Okay, thank you, Courtney.
David.
Will?
Anyone have anything more to say about Mrs. Chick?
Cindy?
Yeah, he asked, one of the things she wanted, I think, is for Mrs. Tox to be the godmother. She had what she thought was a strong case for that.
Yeah, and why does she want Miss Tox to be the godmother?
I mean, other than that's her friend, I think she'd like to link them up as well, you know.
Okay.
David.
Why are they friends in the first place? Why are Mrs. Chick and Miss Tox friends?
Mrs. Chick.
That's a good question.
To exert patronage. She has a superior to inferior relationship.
Yes.
To Miss Tox.
Kathleen Beck.
It seems to me that Mrs. Chick has considerable influence over her brother, but it's because he's not interested in things that do have to do with the domestic sphere. He doesn't really want to know about child care arrangements and things like that. As long as it's taken care of, he's happy to designate that. And Miss Tox is taking advantage of her position as Mrs. Chick's friend to weasel her way into the family, as it were, as a kind of an authority on childcare matters.
I think all of that is correct and useful. I think David's observation that there's a power relationship between Mrs. Chick and Miss Tox is also helpful. That we know that Mrs. Chick is a Dombey. She's of higher status, higher class. Probably higher wealth. We know from things that we learn about Miss Tox later on is that she may be genteel in background, but she's certainly not wealthy. So there's a lot about Miss Tox that we should talk about. But there's also the very interesting idea that a marriage plot for Mr. Dombey is already hatching in these early chapters. It's the plot, you know, the first Mrs. Dombey is gone. Who will be the second Mrs. Dombey?
David, did you have your hand up?
Mrs. Chick also has another status superiority over Miss Tox. Mrs. Chick is married. And unmarried women are definitely, by definition, inferior in status.
A tiger?
Hi. I'm thinking, as soon as I saw her name, Miss Tox, I thought something toxic is this way comes. And who knows how long that will take or if it really, really happens, but I'm tuned into the names he gives people. That's one thing I can say about her.
Okay. Anything else people want to say about Mrs. Chick and Miss Tox?
Peggy?
I just think she amplifies the fact that Dombey doesn't have any awareness or feelings for his wife. You need to see that the Dombey family stay together, the brother and sister, and it's as though, obviously, Mrs. Dombey doesn't have a clue about how much she should revere these wonderful people. And the very fact that nobody really cares much about who the wet nurse is or how it was come by, because she's technically an irrelevant person. I'm not saying within the book, but the book firmly establishes that it isn't his job to notice those things. It's beneath his dignity because he's a wealthy man and he shouldn't be bothering about it. And just as a sideline, you may be interested, my own father, who grew up in Austria, had a wet nurse. So it's amazing to think of it, you know, only a lifetime away.
Tiger already called attention to names, and we know from reading Dickens that names are often an index of some aspect of the character. We'll have to find out as we go further whether there's anything toxic about Miss Tox. But the name Dombey is something we should certainly stop and think about for at least a minute. And I would propose that one of the ways in which that name is resonant is that Dombey is a dummy. That yeah. Dombey, he has no clue about anything about how the world works except for the importance of Dombey and Son. So he's easily manipulated. And it's not just that the world of domestic affairs is beneath him, it's that he is incapable of managing it. And as we learn, well, we will learn later, he's not very capable in lots of other dimensions too. So Dombey, I think, is a dummy.
I totally agree with that one. Yeah. But I would say a candidate for Mrs. Dombey now, after the first one, it can't be a Dombey the way Mrs. Chip is talking about it. Mm-hmm. Because how would that work? You know, you can't have two people who are the top of the power structure and completely clueless. We have one local one, so.
I saw the name Dombey as similar to donkey, so I'm thinking of him as having some of the characteristics of a donkey.
And which characteristics of a donkey would stand out?
Particularly stupidity, not understanding what's going on around him.
Yes. I quite agree.
Unfair to donkeys, but never mind.
Yeah. Phyllis?
Oh, and John, would Dombey qualify as a narcissist?
As a narcissist. That certainly would be one way to think about him. I mean, he's concerned only with himself and with his image of himself. Mm-hmm. And the way that he repeats the phrase, Dombey and Son, you know, he's obsessed with that concept. That's what defines his world, and that's what limits his world, because he can't think of anything outside of that simple phrase.
So he would have put it on more buildings if he could have.
You're thinking of other narcissists.
Well, we have, possibly.
Just saying.
Would it be anachronistic to say that Dombey suggests also zombie, but I'm not sure that was something that was in the vernacular back then. The other thing about Dombey and Son is we have to remember that Dombey himself was a son and grew into being the Dombey. So presumably he has a model that he's following that we don't, is never referred to really directly, but it's something he's lived all his life.
Yes, that's really important too. The title, to go back to the title of the novel, is Dombey and Son. And that's the name of the firm. It's the name of the business, but it's also the name of a family structure. That is, it's father and son. And there was a father, and Dombey was once a son, and now Dombey has become the father. And the importance of Paul's arrival is that Paul is the son. And it's a familial dynasty that will continue to reproduce itself. That's why women, although unfortunately they're necessary, they can never be Dombeys, and they can never be sons.
And that's also the concept of a house, right? And this discussion of that house. It's yes. The house of Dombey, like the house of Usher. I mean, it is.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's a dynastic house, and it's a physical house. I mean, that's why the house is such a, I mean, to say it's a character is perhaps to distort things a little bit, but the house is itself a very powerful presence. And one thing we might do is to, you know, think a little bit about the structure of that house. How many rooms does it have? How many floors does it have? Are there particular rooms that are designated for particular functions? Where does Mr. Dombey fit within the house, the physical house does Mr. Dombey have rooms of his own? What are they like? Anybody have thoughts about how the physical architecture of the house of Dombey fits with the larger themes and patterns in the novel?
So Wendy, then Carolyn, then David.
Thank you, Courtney.
I just was going to say something earlier about doom. And the name Dombey carried doom for me from the start. Okay. Doom boy, in a certain sense. And then going back just for a second to the father and son, there's this powerful passage where he says, I have been and son my whole life. It's only when Paul comes that he becomes Dombey, which you were saying. But what struck me was that he had this identity in his mind as an adult, even though his father was gone, dead, he was in this no man's land, literally. He wasn't really an adult. He wasn't really a man. He was still and son, even though his father was dead. That really struck me. Like he was in this interregnum, and the birth of this child released him from that. Even though the child is so young, he has a destiny, as he says, from the very beginning.
Yes. No, those are very acute observations. And I think that he's not fully a Dombey until he has a son who can help define him as Dombey, the Dombey of Dombey and Son. So he's a son until he has a son of his own, and then he becomes a father and can fully assume the Dombey position. And that notion I think of them as slots or spaces or vacancies that are waiting to be filled is, I think, an important concept for thinking about this novel.
And just quickly to add, that explains why he has to immediately treat this newborn as an adult in order to imaginatively fill that spot.
Yes, and he's very impatient. He can't wait for Paul to grow up. And in some senses, that's part of the problem, is that he wants to force him into adulthood prematurely.
I just got the shivers because there's so many echoes, having been an only child myself and very loved and very honored, but always treated as an adult. That's another story.
Another story.
Yeah.
Irene, I see Irene's hand up.
Yes, I wanted to comment on your question about the rooms and where people were, because I thought one of the strong images was of Mr. Dombey closing up the house after the death of his wife. It's almost as if until his son is old enough to take over as his partner in the company, the house will not be needed. He just uses a tiny corner of it for himself and covers everything else up. There's a kind of interregnum until Paul is of age, so that in the interim, there is no real life in that house.
It's a house of death, or a house that is in a kind of state of non-being until Polly Toodle comes in, right? And Polly Toodle brings life into the house.
Can I ask about the Polly Toodle? Because I'm thinking of her as Polly Richardson. Where is she referred to as Polly Toodle?
She's the same person.
It is the same person.
Yeah. I believe so. Yeah.
Well, one of the things that happens, of course, is that Mr. Dombey insists that she not carry the name that is her proper name, and calls her Richards, insists that she be known as Richards. And why does he do this?
I suppose, Aspie?
Iger, go.
It may have something to do with the language of how language came through in England. Maybe Dombey has a more Anglo sound and Toodles has a more Saxon sound. I don't know enough about that, but that could be. I was also gonna say, it's a bit out there, but of all these women, Polly Toodles, with all her children beside her, has probably the best sex life of anyone there. And so she's gayer, she's lively, and that's what I heard when you said she brings life to the house, although she no longer can consort with her husband at that time, but she has life happening in her.
So Carolyn, then David, Barbara, and Melody.
Thank you, Courtney.
Well, I was just going to say that this has to do with the family structure, but also what you were saying about what does Mrs. Chick get out of Miss Talks. My thought is that Miss Talks is a sycophant, but she's very pliable and ready to play along with whatever Mrs. Chick wants to do. And so it's a power thing for Mrs. Chick to have two instead of one. Somebody's always supporting her. And someone's always backing her up with whatever crazy thing she comes up with.
Just to comment on that and agree with that statement, one of the things to notice in this novel, it's a very small thing that has to do with language, is the way in which people leave sentences unfinished and other people complete the sentences. So one of the games that Mrs. Chick and Miss Tops play is that Mrs. Chick will make a sentence, leave the ending of the sentence vacant, there's usually a dash, and then Miss Talks is there to supply the ending of the sentence. But there's sometimes that Miss Talks gets the ending wrong and Mrs. Chick scolds her for getting the end of the sentence wrong. But this you'll see this pattern elsewhere in the novel, that there are people who leave their sentences unfinished because they want to exert power over the subservient person to finish their sentences for them. And then there are other people who leave sentences unfinished because the person who finishes the sentence is usurping the power of finishing the sentence. So it's a complicated game, but it's throughout this novel. So look for that pattern of unfinished sentences and then what's going on when the sentence gets finished. So thank you for that observation. Who's next? David.
I think I am.
David.
A couple of things. First, about the house.
Yes.
Dombey's closing up all but his own suite is like what he has done with his life. He doesn't live a full life. He doesn't occupy all the rooms of his own body. He ignores his daughter. He doesn't have real social relations. He's closed off. But I wanted to go back to what you said about at the beginning about this being a different book, a first mature book. One of the things that interests me about it is the beginning. This is the first time he's begun a full novel where he plunges into it. The earlier books are much more 18th century. There's a good deal of preliminary throat clearing in the first chapters. Here we go right in. Son was, Dombey was. I think he'd probably gotten some taste of this with Christmas Carol. And at the time Dombey and Son started being published, Thackeray's Vanity Fair was already running. And that has one of the more memorable beginnings in Victorian novels. I'm sure Dickens was aware of it. But from this point on, he's realized that you can do an awful lot with the first chapter to set the tone of the book. And it's interesting watching him develop that.
Yes, thank you. Those are good observations. One could say that in A Christmas Carol, you can see the beginnings of this command of language that I think Dombey exhibits in both the opening paragraphs and at many other points throughout the novel, that A Christmas Carol is a work of Dickens's maturity. And Dombey is the first novel at full length in which that maturity is on exhibit. And to see Dombey and Thackeray side by side, I mean, they are the two premier novelists of the middle of the century. And they're in competition. Both of them are selling novels in monthly installments. Each of them is looking at the sales of the other. At a certain point, Thackeray says, "I can't top what Dickens is doing." And Thackeray recognizes Dickens's greatness and superiority.
Barbara? Barbara, you're muted.
Yeah, I do. I wanted to talk about two things briefly. I love the language in this book. And when it starts out and it talks about the baby being all tucked up in front of the fireplace, being toasted like a muffin, I just thought that was wonderful. You know, it was just, you know, really Dickens. And then when you were talking about the servants, you know, naming, going from Polly, I forgot, to Toodles?
Toodles.
To Richards is like erasing her. Mm-hmm. You know, she's not a person, she's a function. And I remember there was a time in Downton Abbey where they go to visit a much more traditional family. And the butler just renamed them all. Everybody that came as part of their entourage got a new name, and it was the same name. And they just, you know, he said, "I don't care, that's your name here." You know, so I guess it was something that went on for quite a while in England until maybe after World War I.
Two things. I think those are good observations both. The opening paragraph with that notion of the father and son and Paul like a muffin being toasted, it's funny. This is a very funny novel.
It is.
You know, it has many serious aspects to it. I mean, it's exploration of gender, it's exploration of family dynamics, of parents and children, it's exploration of, we haven't even mentioned the railroad, the coming of the railroad, industrialization, modernity in its most mechanical form. But it's also hilariously funny. And much of the humor comes from the language, from the narrator's sense of playfulness. And Mr. Dombey is often a butt of the humor. You have to understand that Mr. Dombey, you may whatever you think about his views on women or on class structure or on money or on child raising and so on, he's also the object of a lot of the humor of the book. And it's this, I think, has to do with the donkey or Dombey dummy aspect. He's a stiff. He's uptight. Think of these metaphors that we use to describe people. He's so uptight, so incapable of dealing with normal human relations that he's funny, and you know, he's horrible at the same time and pathetic. There's something sad about Dombey because he doesn't have access to a full life, and there is a full life around him that he could participate in if he were able to. But so, yes. And then the second point, that to name Polly Toodle as Richards is to erase her. And Dombey is, it's a contract. Human relations for Dombey are all contractual. They're not interpersonal. There's no human dimension to this employment. He insists on having the right to rename her. And to rename her is to cut her off from her family. She's no longer Polly Toodle. And at one point, Dombey asks Polly's husband, do you object to my calling her Richards? And he says, I don't object. I would know her anywhere, whatever name she had. And, you know, that's the Toodle family. They know each other as human beings. The label doesn't matter. Mr. Dombey doesn't want to have human relations because one important reason of that is that other people, he might be obligated to them. Here, Polly Toodle is doing something crucial, something essential for Dombey and Son. She's providing the breast, the wet nurse function that will enable Paul to grow up and become the son that Dombey wants. But he doesn't want to be obligated to her. He doesn't want to be obligated to anyone. He wants Dombey and Son to be a self-sustaining system. And there's this minor inconvenience that women have to bear children. But he would just as soon get women out of the way as fast as he can.
So we have six people who have their hands up. So Melody is next.
Okay, I was originally wanted to talk about Polly being renamed, but that's been discussed. And I wanted to go back to the Dombey's house question, because as I was reading this, I was thinking, you know, how horrible that house must have been, cold and dark. And it reminded me of the title, Bleak House, because Bleak House is not bleak. It's a lovely place. And I was just playing in my mind, well, that house should be called Bleak House, and then Bleak House should be called, I don't know, something else house. But what has occurred to me in the discussion is that when we just came off reading Pickwick Papers, which was Dickens learning how to write a novel and jumping back and forth and throwing in all those little vignettes and so on. And when I started rereading this, I thought, oh my God, this is really Dickens. It's so beautiful and tightly written. And it's not full of things that you wonder, what is that doing there? That doesn't belong there. You know it belongs there, even if you don't know yet why it belongs there. And I'm just having so much fun. I haven't read this in years. So,
well, thank you. I quite agree. I mean, this is Dickens in full command of his powers.
Yeah.
And it has the humor that you saw in Pickwick, and it has other dimensions. So
next up is Carolyn Schwartz. Carolyn.
John, in relation to what you said about the house, I think it's a house of cruelty, led by Dombey, even though I don't think it's intentional. It's just his way of interacting. And I think the cruelest thing he did was, you know, after Florence is lost, that he discharges Richardson, Polly. And I think it was a death sentence for Paul, because it really wasn't clear after she leaves, was he fed by a bottle? I looked up what he's supposed to have died of, and they felt Paul Dombey dies of consumption, you know, TB. But he exhibited these physical problems from early on. I think it was a failure to thrive. So I think that was a very cruel thing that he did without the intention of doing it. Does anyone know how he was nourished after that? Also, he lost a second mother. You know, I mean, studies have shown children growing up without, you know, mothering and touching, I mean, they have significant problems. Also, when I see Paul, there's a medical condition, premature aging. You've probably seen pictures of children like that. You know, that's how I see Paul, as, you know, kind of looking like that.
Of course, we haven't gotten to the point that you're talking about, but there are so many anticipations of it in the section that we have read. That is the whole discussion about temporaries and permanencies. Paul is a temporary. Paul's not going to last. And that's one of the great surprises in this novel. If you imagine that you're reading it for the first time, perhaps some of you are. And so we've spoiled that part of the surprise. That's okay.
I'm sorry.
But one might reasonably expect that a novel that is about a father and a son is going to have as one of its main stories the growing up of the son, that it will be one of the elements of the novel will be a Bildungsroman plot, a novel of education, how the son grows up. But this particular son is a strange son, a son not thriving, failure to thrive. And, you know, that's the modern, but he's not a normal child. He is a child that some people have compared to an alien, an ET figure. He's compared to a goblin. His relationship with Mrs. Pipchin is very curious. You know, she's a witch and he's fascinated with her, and they have a kind of intimacy that seems based on the recognition by each of them that they are different, that they belong to some uncanny or supernatural sphere. Paul has, you know, he asks questions like, Papa, what is money? You know, that don't seem like the questions that a child of his age would be asking. So, you know, this novel is a realistic novel, but it's also a novel that is shot through with elements of what we could call romance or fairy tale, adventure in a more romantic sense. So we need to talk about what the mode of this novel is. What kind of fiction are we reading? What about that scene with Good Mrs. Brown? We need to talk about that, but let's put that as a question that we'll come back to, because there are other hands that are raised. So
there are 9 raised hands. Would it be helpful for me to put the list in the chat for everyone to see?
I have a really quick thing to say, and it's about breastfeeding the baby. And it's Mr. Chick's funniest line. He says, I thought they could do that with a teapot.
Couldn't we do it with a teapot?
That was so funny. Okay, that's all I have.
Yeah, no, it's a hilariously funny moment. And it shows how the world of men doesn't know very much about the world of women and child raising.
Courtney, if you could put that list in the chat, that would be great.
Sure.
And people, please remember this is being recorded. So if you're not speaking, please mute yourself, because we're getting a lot of feedback now because a lot of people are not muted. So please mute yourself if you're not speaking.
And when you're called on, make sure that you're unmuted.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So next up is Irene. Did you still have a question?
Motion detected at the front door.
No, my question, my point was already spoken by someone else, so I put my hand down.
Phyllis?
Hi. Well, I thought I'd just sort of change the subject a little bit, if that's okay. One of the things that really fascinated me was the wooden midshipman. And you almost get the feeling that he could have named the novel that, if there were an alternate universe. And one thing I love is it at the beginning of chapter 4, it describes what's in the wooden midshipman in the second paragraph as a contrast to what is around it in the first paragraph. So you have Dombey and Son, which is just a very dry financial creation of paper and notes and things. And then you have it surrounded by precious, rich East India house, teeming with suggestions of precious stuffs. It sounds like Silicon Valley or something. We'll go yeah. off in a.
It's a good idea.
And then in the wooden midshipman is this just wonderful list of telescopes, compasses that will fit into the tiniest things and weigh the least, and they're all obsolete, or they're getting there. But so I just love this feeling that there's this tension going on, almost what you mentioned earlier, John, between his throat clearing and now he's going into a new way of writing a novel. I think there's this feeling of what's going on around us in this novel too.
Okay, just to comment on that, I'm glad you brought up the wooden midshipman. There are many things that we could explore in relation to the wooden midshipman. First thing, and most obvious thing that you've already commented on, is that there are 2 business locations, both of them in the city of London. One is Dombey's import-export business. We haven't mentioned what kind of business he's in, but that's what he seems to be doing, as the title of the novel indicates. And then there's Saul Giles's shop, the Wooden Midshipman, which deals with instruments, navigational instruments of all kinds. And there's that rich description of them. And that's associated with a world of seafaring adventure. And there's a major difference between the two, which is that Dombey's business thrives and Saul's business does not thrive. If someone comes in to ask for directions, that counts as a customer. And Saul, as we discover later, is in financial difficulties. But his shop is a wonderful place because of these strange and exotic and romantic instruments, because they all have associations with seafaring and adventure. And Walter, who is the nephew, who's the sort of the son in Saul's shop, is imbued with stories of seafaring and adventure. So there's another plot that is sort of shadowed here or foreshadowed. It's a seafaring adventure. It's a plot that has to do with going to sea and romance and adventure and excitement. And there's also a family. I mean, Saul's shop is a kind of domestic center, which is very different from the domestic center of Mr. Dombey's home. So there are two businesses and there are two families.
Well, and Dickens keeps mentioning also Dick Whittington. That comes up all the time. And yes, that, of course, is the exact opposite of what Dombey thinks. You don't just waltz into London and go off and with your cat and make your fortune, right? And then the other is Robinson Crusoe gets mentioned a few times, yeah, too, which is more of the wooden midshipman kind of feel to life.
So just a couple of other things I would mention. One is that who's the hero of this novel based on the first 10 chapters? Is Walter the hero? Are we going to be reading a novel in which, you know, Walter and Florence, that sort of, you know, we already sense that they're destined to find each other because Walter has already found Florence and there's a relationship that is there. Is this going to be an adventure novel with where Walter is going to take over and be the principal figure whose adventures we will follow, the Nicholas Nickleby or the young hero of many 19th century novels? Or is it not going to be Walter? Why is he called the wooden midshipman? Walter is associated, is there something kind of wooden and stiff and awkward about, you know, is Dickens really interested in that young hero figure? Or is he more interested in something else at this point in writing a novel? So what kind of novel will this be? And it's a multi-plot novel. Dickens, the form of the Victorian novel is multi-plot. There, you know, what are the main plots? So central plot is Dombey and the Dombey family, the Dombey business. So that's one plot. Another plot is Walter and Walter's adventures. A third plot is who's going to be the next Mrs. Dombey? And we've already got Mrs. Chick trying to advance the cause of Miss Tox as a possibility. Then we've got Joey Bagstock. What is Joey Bagstock up to in this novel? You know, so there are various ways in which this novel is still developing, looking for or withholding what the main thread of the story is going to be. Is it going to be a story about Paul and how Paul grows up to become the son and the leader of Dombey and Son? You know, we've already given away that that's not gonna happen. So anyway, I'm glad that you mentioned, and then there's Captain Cuttle. Captain Cuttle, one of the great comic characters in this book. And the Saul Gills and Captain Cuttle are in a way a kind of same-sex couple with a son. So they're fathers and sons there in that, you know, that's a much more supportive, loving family unit than the frozen house Dombey, the morgue of Dombey. Courtney, next question. Thank you for that comment.
So, Kathleen Beck, do you still have a question?
We've kind of moved on. I wanted to make a comment about the House of Dombey, but I think we've gone to a different level here. So okay. I'll defer.
No, you can go ahead with the House of Dombey. We have many threads in this discussion.
Indeed. Well, I was thinking about the issue of coldness.
Yes.
And how that relates to the Dombey buildings as well as the family itself. And one scene that stuck in my mind was after the baptism, when they all come back for a luncheon and all the food is cold and the house is freezing, so that poor Miss Tox is about to turn into a block of ice. So that's very indicative of the family and the house, the physical house. And then yes. Someone just raised the description of the building, the Dombey and Son building, and how barren and cold that is as well. And a third thing is what we referred to much earlier, and that's Susan Nipper's propensity to turn the conversation around. And in that quoted sentence at the end of chapter 3, she refers to the wall.
Yes.
Between the houses, which implies that this is an attached dwelling.
Yes.
But Dombey has a wall between him and all his neighbors and all his human relationships. Yes. So he's kind of shut himself off in many yes. different ways. Yes. And even from Paul, in the sense that when Susan brings Paul down in the evenings to see Dombey, they walk back and forth in the conservatory, which yes. is freezing. And that's his contact with his child until Paul becomes old enough to actually communicate with him.
Yes.
So there's a lot of separation and coldness just built into the whole structure of this part of the novel.
Yes, yeah. that all of those are very good observations. And warm and cold is an important binary in this novel. The Tootle family and the Dombey household. Another thing that fits with what you just said is that Dombey is a prisoner inside his own house. The Dombey house can also, I think, usefully be thought of as a prison. Particularly the suite of rooms that are reserved for Dombey, his library, his rooms are a place where he retreats and where he is not just isolated, but where he has isolated himself, imprisoned himself from all sorts of human feeling and companionship and familial intimacy.
Peggy?
So I'll look again at it from a sort of psychological psychoanalysis point of view. I'm thinking Dombey's got this yearning in him for love and affection and being human that we all have. But the only way it could get to him as far as he's concerned is through his son. So he's really jealous. And no, I don't want my son to get attached to Richards. I don't want to get he's jealous of his son's with Florence. He's jealous with anybody, because the way I kind of see it is that Dombey's sitting there waiting with this yearning inside of him, and it's just all on pause. And the only place he can get it is from his son when he grows up, and he doesn't want his son to do that with anybody else. Mm-hmm. So he becomes this stilted character waiting for it.
Those are very good observations. One can be angry at Dombey, and one can also feel very sorry for him, because I think he does need, he does want, he does yearn for some kind of human connection. And he
yearns for being a Tootle. The Tootles all have it.
Yeah, and the Tootles are prolific. Dombey has, has only two. The Tootles have how many? Six children. Mm-hmm. But related to what you just said, this may seem like it's a tangent, but why does Dombey choose Miss Tox to be the godmother, and Mrs. Chick and Mr. Chick to be godparents? What's the christening is the major scene. It's that frigid scene, but the choice of godparents. I said grandparents, but I mean godparents. Why does Dombey make those choices? Anybody have?
Well, he says he doesn't need a godfather. He has me.
Yeah.
And Mrs. Talk, she's fine because she's very affectionate to the kid. But he's actually doesn't seem to be jealous of her. But he is jealous of his daughter. For sure.
Dombey doesn't want to be obligated to anyone. If he asks someone who has no money, no power, no influence, a Miss Tox, to be a godmother to Paul, she is obligated to him for having been asked. He is in no way obligated to her to be a patron or a beneficiary to Paul, because she has nothing to give to him. Dombey does not want to be beholden to anyone, and to be beholden to Paul's wet nurse would be a problem. I mean, to be obligated to Walter, who saves Florence when she gets lost, is a real problem for Dombey. He wants to pay it off. You don't want to have any human relations that carry with them obligations of reciprocity. You want always to be the one to whom other people are obligated.
Glenna?
Yeah, I mean, I was going to say a couple of things. It's very clear that Dombey has no capacity to enter into relations, human relations, other than as a transaction matter of being transactional. And he values Paul primarily so that there'll be Dombey and Son. He has some glimmer perhaps of human feeling for him, but if he had any kind of genuine human feeling, he would want a nurturing wet nurse. He would be thrilled that little Paul has a doting sister, instead of seeing all this as competition. But he is, his whole worldview is shaped by Dombey and Son. And the other thing I wanted to say, apropos of who's the hero, we briefly met Mr. Carker, the younger. And he's another interesting minor character that we're going to see more of, I do believe. And and I just wanted to say, Major Bagstock is one of my favorite characters. I just love the way, Joey B, my God, and so on and so on. I mean, his monologues are just hilarious. So anyhow, my piece is over.
Okay, we should spend some time on Major Bagstock before we end today.
John? Can yes. I just comment on the one thing you said and other people said about the coldness aspect? It was when Cuddles trinkets, which he considers treasures, were refused by Dombey after the generous clan they have. And it made me shiver because at the end of it, it goes, at this touch of warmth, when he puts his hook Remember, he touches him with both, and it says, at this touch of warm feeling and cold iron, Mr. Dombey shivered all over, which basically made me shiver. And so the coldness, as you all pointed out in the house and in the very person, you know, it's unavoidable. The notion of a human touch, especially by someone as insignificant as Carlo, you know, was just a really pathetic thing. And then when
you were breaking up there, and it was hard to make out what you were saying, but I got the gist of it. Yeah, the
I don't know if you heard me talk about the shivering a Dombey with the touch of the iron and the hand on him.
Captain Cuttle, one of the comic things about him is the prosthesis that he has. He's yes. lost a hand, and but he's remarkably adept with the hook that he has in place of a hand, and he can unscrew the hook and screw in a knife and use it to eat his meals with.
But when he holds his palm, Dombey's hand in both a hand and a hook, I mean, it's so literally touching, because yes. even his hook is warmer than any part of Dombey. You know?
Yes, the cold iron, there's a gesture of friendship there on Cuddle's part. Cuddle does not acknowledge the class distinction that exists between Dombey and himself. And we should think about and talk about social class in this novel. What class is Mr. Dombey, for example? How does class, it's obvious in relation to the Tootle family, who are working class, and Mr. Tootle works for the railroad. But there are other ways in which class is very important. But Cuddle is oblivious to social class. He goes to Dombey's house, walks in with Walter, and then when Dombey has provided the funds that Walter has requested, shakes Dombey's hand. And Dombey is astonished that someone should presume to shake his hand. To shake his hand as a gesture of thanks and friendship. And it's that moment where the cold iron of Cuddle's hook, of his prosthesis, is warmer than the emotional coldness of Mr. Dombey. It's a wonderful scene.
Right. Wonderful scene.
Yeah.
Catherine?
I just wanted to say, just to go back for a moment to the idea of naming and the names that people have or are imposed on them. And it seemed to me that Major Bagstock is the antithesis of Polly in that regard. Although a new name is imposed on her by Mr. Dombey, she remains the same. And as her husband says, he would know her anywhere, and she still loves her family in the same way, and nothing about her changes. But the Major gives himself new names all the time, constantly referring to himself by variants of his own name, in the same way that he seems to have no fixed personality. He seems at first to be kind of lovelorn gentleman, and then he becomes the scheming villain. And that instability of character and instability of naming is very sinister, and I think something that you see in many of Dickens' novels. But it's just interesting to see how even in these chapters, we're seeing those characters that we can trust who don't change no matter how they're referred to, and those who can't even refer to themselves in a trustworthy way.
Very good observations. Oh, we should talk more about Major Bagstock and what he's doing and what his motives are and what his role in the novel up to this point. I mean, you've started us in an excellent direction in talking about him. He's the name changes, the sort of, they're all variants of his given name, but he likes to play with his name. There's a I think of it as a sort of self-stroking. He likes to stroke himself by playing with his name. But his relationship with Miss Tox, his relationship with Dombey, we should think about those, and I'd be interested if people have comments. But let's go on with the questions. We can come back to that.
Barbara, do you still have a question or comment?
Okay, I'm unmuted. We've gone pretty much past it, but I just wanted to say, first of all, until you mentioned her, we had never talked about Florence at all, and I think she's a very important part of the novel from the beginning. And the fact that she's skulking in a corner all the time, this shows part of his feelings toward women and his total indifference toward her. But as well as Paul and his lack of a mother, I think Florence is the closest thing he ever gets to being a mother. She really, sometimes you think that siblings are going to be jealous of each other or something. And she has probably good reasons that she could be. You know, he's going to get everything. He's going to get all the attention. She's et cetera, but she's not. She loves him and she adores him and she takes really good care of him. And I really do think she is his mother's substitute until the day he dies. So that's going back a bit, but
No. It's very pertinent and it's true. We haven't spent as much time on Florence in our discussions today as she deserves. And she's there from the very beginning. I mean, that wonderful opening scene where the focus is on father and son, and gradually we learn that there are three women in the room who don't get mentioned. There's the nurse, there's of course the mother who is in the process of dying, and then there's Florence. And the most emotional scene in that opening chapter is the embrace that takes place between mother and daughter. I mean, Florence is the figure of emotion and tenderness and love in that household. And but the death of the mother, this goes back to something that I'm interested in as a structural feature in the novel, creates a vacancy. It creates an absence. So the first question is, who is going to replace that absent mother? And there are many candidates from the very beginning as to who will be Paul's mother. And one of them is Florence. I mean, Florence as a sibling, but as an older sibling and as a girl, can in some ways be the nurturing female figure in Paul's world. There is a bond that develops between them. But Mrs. Chick and Miss Tox are candidates to become Paul's mother. And the attentions that they give to him, particularly Miss Tox, because Miss Tox would very much like to be the next Mrs. Dombey. And Mrs. Chick, obviously Dombey's sister, can't become Dombey's wife. But the next best thing would be for her to provide a wife for Dombey. That would be something that she could do that would increase her power and influence in the Dombey family. So Miss Tox is a candidate to be Paul's mother. And she actually takes Paul back to Princess's place, the little apartment where she lives, which is another location that we've been talking about, locations and places, and saw the wooden midshipman, Dombey's business, Dombey's home, obviously. But Princess's place is another important location. And that's where Miss Tox lives, and across from her lives Major Bagstock, whom we just began to talk about. And so one of the things that happens in the section that we read is that Miss Tox takes Paul home with her, and she holds him up at the window and displays him so that Major Bagstock can see that she has a baby in her arms. Is Miss Tox being a mother to Paul? Not exactly. I don't think she's. And then at a certain point, Miss Tox recommends Mrs. Pipchin. So what's going on when Miss Tox, seconded by Mrs. Chick, supports the idea of Paul going to be with Mrs. Pipchin? My hunch is that they have recognized, that is Mrs. Chick and Miss Tox, have recognized that Paul is not thriving. And they don't want to be responsible or to be in a position where they could be held responsible for Paul's failure to thrive. So they would rather have Paul go out of the house and have someone else be in charge of taking care of Paul, because that way he's off their hands. They're the ones who communicate with the doctor. The doctor says, Paul's not doing very well. Dombey has no clue about that because he can't really see his son. He can't deal with his son as a real child. So he has his grand notion of what Paul will become, and that prevents him from seeing Paul as a sickly child. Miss Tox and Mrs. Chick have a more realistic view of infant development, and much as they would like to have the benefits of doing something good for Paul, I think they also want to avoid the responsibility of being the ones in charge when something bad happens to Paul. So Mrs. Pipchin is another candidate for Paul's mother in the early sections of the novel. So two things I'm interested in, if we're done with the series of questions. Good Mrs. Brown and more about Joey Bagstock.
Megan, do you still have a question? Gary?
Just briefly, and it ties into what, to some degree, John, you just talked about, as it relates to Miss Tox holding the child at the window. And I was just thinking in terms of that original question you had about the house and the Dombey house being one that's very separate and isolated in a sense and very, you know, dark in many ways. Whereas you have the character of the major who is watching across the way and seeing Miss Tox with the child. And there's sort of this openness that starts to happen with that scene in a sense. And I don't know, it might be a stretch here, but the idea of class and how class in some sense, it's to see upper class into the privacy of upper class. You're seeing, you know, very openly the major's essentially spying on Miss Tox, and he can see exactly what, and I don't know if that's just a thought about that relationship. And then in addition to that, just the role of Florence being out in the world, and as you brought up, and we'll talk about, no doubt, her being kidnapped by Mrs. Brown, and just this difference between the world of the house being very close and the world of the major and Miss Tox and what happens later is being very open.
Okay. Other comments about Major, Miss Tox, and we should come back to Florence's kidnapping too. Yes, Carolyn, I see your hand.
I find Major Bagstock kind of charming, and because it seems to me there were so many wars in England. So these people, you know, it seems like he's never been married. Their life was being in the military. You know, they may have distinguished them there. And then they come back to reality. And it's like, and now what did they do? And, you know, I think he's just doing the best he can. He's okay. Kind of charming.
Charming, okay. He's one of Dickens's grotesque figures. He's mm-hmm. he's blue. His eyes bulge out. He's compared to prawns and lobsters. He's hoarse. He wheezes a lot. He coughs. He does this funny thing with his name that he he keeps playing with his name. He has a servant whom he abuses regularly. He's military. We might ask also the question about social class in relation to the major. What class does he belong to? And we should also be more specific about Dombey's social class. Where does Dombey fit in the hierarchy of the class structure of Victorian England? So that's a bunch of questions. Yes, David, did you have a hand up?
Thinking back to Mrs. Gamp and the previous Dickens novel, Major Bagstock is his own Mrs. Harris. He praises himself,
yes.
Social class, if he really was a major, that makes him a gentleman, at least in theory. Mr. Dombey is not retail, so he's a step above being looked down on as in trade. He's in a different social ranking. He's in the city ranking rather than in society. Presumably he would be known by people like the members of the companies in the city. He has his status, but it's not a general society status. Am I right?
Yes, all of that is correct. And it would not be inaccurate to say that Dombey is middle class. He is definitely not of the elite society. He's not genteel. The major is actually his superior in social status, whatever one might think about the major personally. The major goes to a club and he talks about his life and his friendship with Dombey and his relationship with Miss Tox to the other members of the club. It's a gentleman's club. So he has that genteel status or that foot, if you will, in a higher level of society. When Dombey first meets the major, that is the major arranges because of his relationship with the father of Master Bitherstone, who's one of Paul's classmates at Miss Pipchin's, to meet Dombey. It's the major who has arranged that meeting. One of the things that Dombey does after the first meeting is to check in the military register to find out who Major Bagstock is. So he's checking to see if the major is indeed a major, an officer in the British Army. I mean, that's an important position. So Dombey, having ascertained that the major is what he claims to be, is more open to a friendship with the major. What is the function of the major in Dombey's life? Goodness, Dombey has a friend. We've never had any indication that Dombey has a friend. The major is there filling a vacancy. Who is Dombey's best friend? Dombey has no friends at all, no male friends. He lives in a world that is a patriarchal world. He has the business, which is an all-male affair, but otherwise he's surrounded by women. Dombey's world is a world of women in which he is ostensibly the most powerful, but easily manipulated. He's the dummy or the donkey or whatever who gets led by the women in the whatever direction they want to lead him. So the major is of a higher social status than Dombey. There are other indications about Dombey's social status that appear in the opening chapter. Mrs. Dombey has given birth and she's not in good health. Dombey has summoned two doctors. He has summoned the family doctor whose name is Pilkins, not a particularly distinguished sounding name. And he's also summoned another doctor. And the other doctor keeps confusing Dombey or pretending to confuse Dombey with Your Grace or the Duke of this, and because he is the physician to the aristocracy. Why has Dombey summoned another doctor? He is not content to have only the middle class physician attending on Mrs. Dombey. He wants the aristocratic doctor to be present because he values the class connection there. And Dombey's class position is an insecure one in that respect. Dombey is always looking up. He would like to be more closely connected with people of higher social status. So Dombey's social anxiety, Dombey is particularly comfortable with people who are his social inferiors. That's why he's happy to have Mr. Chick be a godfather and Miss Tox to be a godmother, because they are of inferior social status to Dombey. But Dombey is happy to be befriended by the major, who is of a higher standing. So what's the major up to? What's he trying to do? Gary got us started on by talking about the spying. There's a lot of mutual looking that is going on between Miss Tox and the major.
Martha?
Well, I was going to say that Bagstock really likes Miss Tox and he doesn't like this competition. So he's checking it all out.
Yeah.
Trying to befriend Dombey so he can learn more.
There's a powerful flirtation going on between Miss Tox and Major Bagstock. She's displaying herself to be viewed by the major. The major is a voyeur who's looking at her and flirting with her. She likes his attention. It's a sexy plot that is developing, but as soon as she displays the bracelet that Dombey has given her because she's the godmother, and she conspicuously holds it up for him to see, the major gets jealous. So the major wants to subvert the plot that is developing. There's a rival. Who is the rival? He finds out that it's Dombey. Ah, so the major will intervene. He will become the best friend of Dombey, and he will drive a wedge between Miss Tox and Dombey to prevent that flirtation from developing, because it's a strange little love triangle that is going on here, where Miss Tox is angling to become the next Mrs. Dombey. The major would like to continue having himself as the center of her erotic imagination. And so the way to do that is to befriend the rival. In a sense, they're doing that familiar game of two men exchanging a woman. Women are objects of exchange in a patriarchal society in a number of different ways.
Dan, did you have a question?
Dr. Jordan actually just answered it for me. That was kind of what I was going to say. He's out to get revenge on Mrs. Tox for scorning him. So.
Yeah, exactly. I see we've got about 10 minutes left. I wanted to ask you about the Good Mrs. Brown part.
Doesn't she bring us straight back into the fairy tale aspect?
Exactly. One of the things that, here's my experience. This is my explanation. We're reading what's mostly a realistic novel. It's easy to sort of follow the story and see how the characters relate to each other. And then suddenly, the bottom drops out of the realistic story. There's a crowd scene, Florence gets separated, and boom, we're in the fairy tale. Good Mrs. Brown. Oh, I like your hair. I've got a daughter. Well, you know, I could kill you at any moment now. It's Hansel and Gretel, the witch that has abducted the child. Boom, except it's still just realistic enough so that, it's scary. I mean, if you put yourself in Florence's position at that point, suddenly the world you know has vanished and you're in different clothes, you're carrying a rabbit skin, you're in rags, the bottom has dropped out of Florence's life there. And we're in a very scary other world, a romance world, but not the world of Dick Whittington and happy endings, but a world in which life is in danger and poverty is very real. Mrs. Brown says something about having a daughter who's in foreign lands. She's a witch, and it's, a witch Mrs. Pipchin is also a witch, but Mrs. Pipchin isn't a threat to Paul. Paul is her equal. They're from the same world. If they're both part of fairy tales, they're on the same level, but Florence is not on the same level as Good Mrs. Brown. Good Mrs. Brown is the scariest figure we have met thus far in the novel, because she has that supernatural dimension as well as a grounding in the very real world of urban poverty. So I think she's a wonderful surprise. Then the other thing we haven't talked about is the railroad. One of the ways in which this novel is important in the history of British fiction is that it's, if not the first, it's one of the very first pieces of prose narrative to introduce a vivid description of the construction of the railroad, the major technological advance of the 19th century, of the first half of the 19th century. And the first description, it's in chapter, is it chapter five? I'm forgetting the number at this point, but it's in monthly number two, begins as a description of an earthquake. And if you're reading it for the first time, you might think it it's an actual earthquake that has occurred. But it's not an earthquake. It's a technological earthquake that has been produced by the construction of the railroad and the way in which a traditional community, one that has the pastoral title of Staggs's Gardens, what could be more Elizabethan pastoral than a name like that, is totally disrupted by the construction that comes with building a right-of-way for the railroad that will follow. And one of the major themes in this novel is modernity versus what is often described in a number of different ways as old-fashioned. What are the things that are old-fashioned in this novel? Paul is old-fashioned. Saul Gill's shop is old-fashioned. It's behind the times. What are the things that are modern? Well, the railroad is the most modern. Curiously enough, Tootle, who works for the railroad, is, you could claim that Tootle is the most modern man that we have met in the early part of the novel. Who else is modern? Who else is old-fashioned? What about Walter? Is Walter a modern man? Or is Walter old-fashioned? Is his attachment to fantasies of Dick Whittington and adventures at sea and his relationship with Captain Cuddle and Sol Gills, does that place him in a world of the old? Or is he potentially a man of the new world? Will he be able to transform himself? Or is that a question for him? And what about Mr. Dombey himself? Is Mr. Dombey the man of modernity? Or is he old fashioned? Where does he fit on that spectrum, if you will, of the old and the new, or the modern and the outmoded? Saul Gills and Captain Cuddle seem to be sort of at the far end of the old-fashioned and the not up-to-date, the out-of-date. But what about Mr. Dombey? Is Mr. Dombey a modern man or an old-fashioned man? In a couple of minutes that we have left, does anybody want to venture a guess?
So we have Wendy and Wayne, and then Trudy and Linda.
And then we're going to end after those questions.
So Wendy?
Yes, it's not a question to what you just said, John, but I just am so fascinated with why I never knew about Dombey and Son until the age I am now. And I love this book so much. I read the whole thing, luckily, before we started. And I just wonder why it hasn't been on my radar until now. I had trouble even getting a copy. So that, you don't have to answer that now, but just mark that for a future discussion. I don't get why it's not at the top of the list of Dickens' works, because clearly you agree that it's a marvelous work, and many of us do.
Wayne?
Well, this is a throwback to Mrs. Brown. I have to admit that passage is so frightening that I still skip it, even as an adult, when I reread this novel. It is an amazingly horrifying scene. That's all I had.
One thing I would toss in, we haven't talked at all about the illustrations, and the illustrations to Dombey and Son are wonderful. And if you have a chance, I mean, I hope everyone has access to the illustrations, but and you can find them online if you don't have them in the edition that you're using. But I recommend that you look at the scene where that immediately precedes the kidnapping of Florence. It's a crowd scene, and you remember the crowd is mostly attacking Byler, the schoolboy who's dressed in the uniform. But see if you can identify the characters in that illustration. It's a very interesting illustration. So who else is on our list?
Me. Hello.
Trudy.
Hi, Trudy.
Yeah, just a couple of things. First of all, I think Florence is also part of the fairy tale story, Cinderella. Mm-hmm. The shoe being put on her foot.
Yep.
But on Mr. Dombey, is he modern or old fashioned? I think he is dead. And he had, and the question is, will he be born?
Okay.
So I think a lot of this story is whether or not Mr. Dombey will ever be brought to life.
Mr. Zombie.
Mr. Zombie, yeah. Will he be brought to life? When we first read this, I worked on doing a paper on it, and I was going to compare this book to Crime and Punishment. I didn't get the paper finished, but I still think of it and the birth of Raskolnikov, right?
Good question. Will Mr. Dombey? Will he come to life?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Because all you've said about the coldness, the lack of connection, the lack of any human connection, and so on, does make him. Not the zombie, because the zombie is, you know, you said at one point, he's a stick, you know, he's a,
the narrator calls him at the beginning of that christening scene, frigid calls Dombey a type of frozen gentleman.
That's right. Yeah, he's not, you know, so another way of put it is, will he thaw out?
Will he thaw out?
Yeah.
Okay.
Think of that as kind of a thread to develop in the book.
We have anyone else? Closing comment?
Linda, did you have your hand up? Anyone else?
I love seeing people and saying hi and goodbye.
It's nice to see so many faces, so many familiar ones. So it's good to be back together. Good to be talking about Dickens. And I couldn't agree more, Dombey, Wendy. Dombey and Son is a great novel.
Yeah.
It's very, very nice to see people.
Yeah.
See you next month.
Yes.
Stay safe. Be well.
You too.
Thank you, Courtney.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
Thank all of you.
All right.
Thank you.
Love you guys.
Love you.
Thank you.
All right.